Chapter. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Somebody bearing witness already. I praise God for that. Amen. In the Gospel of St. Mark, chapter number 4, those that have your Bible, amen, we want to draw our attention to the 35th verse. We're going to read, amen, down to the 41st verse. And then again, we're going to look at verse number 35, and from there, amen, we're going to pull out our subject or text for today. Those that have your Bible, St. Mark, Gospel, chapter number 4, beginning from verse 35, and it said, "And the same day, when the evening was come, he said unto them, Let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship. And there also with him of other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat unto the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awake him and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind. And he said unto the sea, Peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there were a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are you so afraid or so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. And they feared exceedingly, and they said one to another, What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? Verse 35 says, And the same day. Seems as though that everything that the Lord is going to say hereafter, amen, it is undergirded by that parenthesis, and the same day. Because the scripture said, and the same day when the evening was come, he said unto them, Let us pass over unto the other side. Those that have been in church any time, those that even write and divide the word of truth, would understand my subject. And my subject today is, let us go over to the other side. Let's go over to the other side. The text helps us because it is here from St. Mark's Gospel, chapter number 4, verses 35 through 41. A very familiar passage of scripture because it deals with Jesus quieting the sea. It's interesting because it is in this text that we can pull, amen, out of it, amen, to give us assurance that, amen, even with God in our life, sometime we all have to pass or all have to go through a storm. But, amen, what is interesting that even in a storm, amen, we have a God that has the power and the ability, amen, to quiet the storm, amen, praise God, when we go through it. He's a mighty God. He's El Shaddai. He's Elohim. He's sovereign. He's omnipotent. He's omnipresent. He's, amen, omniscient. He's, amen, the God of heaven and earth. And the Bible declares that it is in him that we live and move and have our being. Whenever, amen, we look at the text, amen, it always speaks to us, amen, in the present, amen, and it helps us, amen, to understand our God, amen, in the future. He said, let us go over. over to the other side. In other words, amen, when you know who he is, come on somebody, amen, you don't have to be afraid, you don't have to be ashamed, because if God speak it, amen, he will, amen, bring it to pass. He begun a good work in you, and because he begun a good work in you, he is able to perform it unto the appearance of Jesus Christ. When God speak it, just wait on it. He will bring it to pass. Amen. He might not come when you want him, but he's right on time. You don't have to wait till the battle's over. You can shout right now. That's why I can testify out of all I've been through, I still got joy. He brought me through the water. He brought me through the fire, and he brought me to my resting place. I want to preach to somebody, and I want to talk about three points today. I want to talk about the mission. I want to talk about the miracle, and I want to talk about the master, because we must understand in the text here that it seems as though that in the Gospel of St. Mark that Jesus saw in this chapter that it was very important to be able to teach unto his disciples his doctrine. Now, in other words, he took the time out, amen, to speak to them in parables, because, amen, Jesus knew that there would come a time that they would have to face their calamities and their adversities. He knew, amen, that there would be a time in their life that he would no longer be with them, and he taught them through parables because, amen, he wanted them to understand that there are certain things that I'm trying to speak unto you, that everyone around you not only don't have the ability, amen, to, amen, be revealed unto them, but everything that I say out of my mouth is not for everybody. We must understand that, because that whenever God speaks to us as believers, we need to understand, amen, who is talking, who he is talking to, amen, and what he's talking about, because everybody today said they are spiritual, everybody today said they are Christians, everybody said today that they are saved, but I beg the record today, because when Jesus came, he came with a purpose. He came to seek and to save those that are lost. So if everybody is already saved, the question is, why did Jesus come? He did not come to give us houses and land. He did not come, amen, to make us prosper and not have a need. But he came because the Bible declares that we were all born in sin and shaken in iniquity. The Bible says all of our righteousness was as filthy rags. The Bible declared that we was born in sin and shaken in iniquity. We came here, amen, all messed up. We was thrown up from the floor up. We was wrangling in a can of crowd. We was messed up, amen, from the inside out. But I come to tell you today that the only reason why we got it together is because Jesus came to take us out of darkness unto this marvelous light. That's why I've come to tell you, let's go over unto the other side. We don't have to stay in the same place day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year, decade after decade, century after century, because God has given us a promise that if I bring you to it, I'm going to bring you through it. I don't know about you, but the text helps me to understand, amen, the purpose of God is to take us from one place to another. He didn't come here for us to stay the same, but the only reason why he came is because he wanted to change us from, amen, faith to faith and glory to glory. I told the word out of Sunday school that the only reason why you're here today is because God had a purpose and a destiny for your life. He didn't want to make you a millionaire, even though some people millionaire. He didn't want to make you to be something, amen, above yourself. But when he looked down through time, through his foreknowledge and through his predestination, amen, he wanted you to be conformed into his image. He created us to be like him. Because Adam failed in the garden, and now man was marred. And instead of us looking like him, we find ourselves being opposite of who he is. So Jesus came, amen, to bring us to a place now that not only that we have the ability and the power, but he has not given us purpose and destiny that we can be conformed into the image of his son. If anybody had questions before you came to church today, what God has for me, I come to tell you that God has greatness for you. It was in Jeremiah 29:11. So he said, he know his thoughts toward you, and his thoughts is good and not evil, and he have given us an expected end. In other words, when you get in him, he gives us hope, he gives us expectation. When you get in him now, you not stand in the same place that you are in. And that, amen, takes away, amen, any doctrine or any teaching that makes us feel like that we're here without a purpose. He didn't just put us in the earth to exist. It's not, amen, an accident that you're here today. But, amen, you're here because he want to bring you over, amen, from death to life, from sickness to healing, from sorrow to joy. Amen, can I suggest that it's time to go over onto the other side? So the text says, in verse number 35, can I exegete just a little here? Amen. It declares in this chapter, he said, and the same day when the evening had come. What that suggests to us now, amen, that what God is getting ready to do, he can do it right now. The Bible said today is the day of his salvation. You don't have to wait till tomorrow. You don't have to put it off to next week. He is a prisoner in the time of trouble. The Bible said that the poor man cried unto the Lord, and the Lord heard him and delivered him out of all of his trouble. When did God deliver us? Whenever we put ourselves in a position now that we are dependent on him. He said, humble yourself in the hand of God, and in due time, what will he do? Exalt you. So when we put ourselves in the spirit of humility, when we put ourselves into the place now that God, we in need of you, we can't do it without you. Lord, without you, I can do nothing. The Bible said, with a broken heart and a contrite spirit, he said, I will no wise turn you away. So in other words, when we put ourselves in a position now that we surrender unto him, then now God, not only will he show up in your life, but he will show out. Look to your neighbor and say, the Lord will show out. But for him to show out, you got to be willing to go over to the other side. You got to be willing to make a change in your life. The places that you used to go, you can't do it. No, you ever need the things that you used to do, you don't do it no more. Because I'm getting ready to go over to the other side. Put your hands together and say, I'm going over. I'm going over. So what the text suggests here, that Jesus will come right where you at today. Secondly, it suggests to you and I that we got to put ourselves in a position that we tarry with him. For the Bible said when evening was come, that suggests to me that they had been following him prior to God getting ready to quiet in the sea. God had been with them prior to the storm. He had been with them prior to their testing and their trial. That's the discussion that we had in the office. Because religion makes you feel that only God was with you only when you came and shook the preacher's hand. Amen. It makes you feel that the only reason why God is with you because you said the sinner's prayer. The only reason God was with you because you confessed with your mouth and believed in your difference today, because we serve a God that had said, y'all ain't saying nothing, when you was dead in your trespasses and in your sin, Christ died for the ungodly. Y'all ain't saying nothing. He had you in the mind when you was in the club. He had you on his mind when you were running from man to man, from woman to woman. He had you in your mind when you was convicted of a crime. He had you in your mind when you was addicted to alcohol and drugs. I come to tell you that no man can come to the Father except he. Can I take my time? I got to preach. Somebody need to know the gospel story. But can I take my time? Because the same day, amen, when evening had come, those that read your Bible would understand that it is in the fourth chapter now that Jesus, he began to teach to them in parable. That parable is a natural story that gives a spiritual principle. A parable is that which God will speak, amen, to his people or to those that are chosen for by him, because it is their time and not those around them time. That's why you got to be careful, believers, when you put your business out when God speaks a word in your life, because the word might be for you, but it might not be for everybody around you. Amen. The problem of speaking things, amen, prematurely is a lot of speaking to, they're not celebrators, but they're tolerators. They're not, amen, going to push you to your destiny, but they're going to pull you away from what God has for you. So God speaks to them in parable. Amen. In chapter number 4, the Bible says that he talked to them in the sea, and he gathered a great multitude, and he entered into the ship. I'm just preaching on how. But notice what he said here, and he speaks to them, and he said, hearken, behold, there were, amen, a soul that went out to sow. Can I take my time? And he said, he came to pass that as he sowed, he said, some fell by the wayside. He said, and the fowls of the air came and devoured it. He said, some fell on stony ground, and when they had not much earth, immediately it springeth up, amen, because it had no depth of the earth. He said, but when the sun was up, he said, it was scorched, and because it had no root, it withered away. Then he said, amen, and some fell among thorns, and amen, the thorns grew up and choked it and yielded no fruit, and others fell on the good ground, and it did yield fruit, and it sprung up, and it increased, amen, and he brought forth some 30, some 60, and some 100. In other words, amen, what Jesus was saying unto his disciples, amen, that I have a mission for you. I have something that, amen, I want you to do. But if you want to be able to fulfill the mission, if you want to be able to go over to the other side, you got to know the importance of having the word of God in your heart. Amen. Before the preacher preach, before the choir sing, before the blessings come, you got to have a word in your heart. I come to tell you that there's nothing more important than coming to church for your praise and worship and not understanding why you are here. The reason why we are here is because God has a word for you, and he helps us to understand that if the word is going to be effective, it got to fall on a good ground. It got to be a condition of your heart. You can't just jump in here because it feels good. You can't just jump in here because those around you are doing it. But when the word of God is being preached, you got to make sure that it falls on good ground. Because Jesus began to explain unto his disciples. In verse number 13, he said, I say unto them, know you not this parable? How then will you know all parables? In other words, what Jesus is saying, If you want to really understand me, you got to understand what I'm saying to you through my word. Because it is the word that illuminates. It's the word that quickens. It is powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword. It pierces asunder between the joint and the marrow, the soul and the spirit. Amen. Timothy said that there's no creature that's not manifested in his sight. There's something about the word of God that it puts us in a place now that we're face to face with God. When we get in the word, it's not about the praise team now. When we get in the word, it's not about how well the preacher preached. But when we get in the word of God, it's about God manifesting himself in your life. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God, and the same was with God in the beginning, and the word was made flesh, and we beheld his glory, the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. I come to tell you that God want to do something in your life, but when he start to work, he's going to do it from the inside out. And it's funny that we dress up from the outside in. We say if we put on the right suit, if we wear the white dress, if we buy the right hair to make it put our weed, oh, hell, I say nothing. If we go to the right barber, if I drive the right car, if I live in the right neighborhood, then surely I feel good about myself. But God told me to tell you that the only way that you truly is going to feel good about yourself, it got to be from the inside out. God want to do something now on the inside. That's why Paul said, I am a new creature. He said, old things are passed away, and the whole old thing, I've become new. I come to tell you that I'm getting ready to go over on the other side. It doesn't matter how the winds of life beats against me. God done gave me a mission. He has given me purpose, and my purpose is to go over on the other side. He has provided the vehicle, the avenue. He has provided the way that I can go over to sin, to salvation, to death, unto life. Is there anybody out there that are willing to take a little trip with me and tell your neighbor, I'm going over on the other side? It doesn't matter what I got to face. It doesn't matter how they look at me. I'm going over. Say yeah. Say yeah. Say yeah.
I'm going over. Sit down and rest yourself. Amen. I don't want to blow your way. If the house is high, turn it down. But we got to be able to realize that God has given us a mission. Just because you're here, God has given you a mission. And the mission is, let's go over to the other side. When you get the word right, y'all ain't saying nothing. When you put the word in the right place, when the word becomes relevant in your life, when the word becomes number one in your life, when you desire the word above the necessary food, good God Almighty, amen. Good God, when you desire the word above the necessary food, you will realize now that it's not about me. It's not so much about us being here today, but it is about what God is doing in your life. And the Bible says that the same day he spoke unto his disciples and said, let's pass over unto the other side. Look at the word pass over. Don't you remember when the children of Israel, they was down in Egypt, they
seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And he said, all of these things will be added. Don't you remember? After the firstborn, he told Israel, kill a man, take the blood, put it over the doorpost. When the deaf angel comes, it's going to pass over. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Because I've been washed in the blood, because of the blood of Jesus, when Ebola come my way, it got to pass over. When poverty come my way, it got to pass over. When liars and haters and backbiters, y'all ain't having it.
Amen. I looked at the word mission, amen, and I broke it down. Because notice the Bible said we all had sinned and come short of the glory of God. We had missed the mark. So God gives us a mission. I'm just preaching here. And I broke it down. Miss I on y'all. Ain't said nothing. It went away ahead. You missed it, but now I'm on it. Y'all ain't said nothing. You missed your blessing, but now I'm on it. You missed what God had for you, but now I'm on it. Ain't that it? God will take that you miss and connect you and give y'all got the gift of mission. I tell you to have some high five. Somebody said, I'm on it. I'm on it. I'm on it. I might not be what I want to be, but I'm on it. I might not have what I need, but I'm on it. I might not look like I'm supposed to look, but I'm on it. I dare you to tell somebody, I'm on it. I'm on it. I'm on it. I'm on it. I'm trying to live right. I'm trying to live holy. I'm trying to do what God called me to do. I'm on it.
So he gives us a mission. I got to go a little further here now, because after a mission, then now we deal with the miracle. Good God Almighty, God want to work miracles in our life. Whenever we deal with a miracle is an effect. It is an extraordinary event. See what God does? He takes the ordinary and he makes it extraordinary. A miracle is an effect. You know why folks ain't getting miracles today? Because they're not letting the word and the spirit affect them like it used to. Ain't helping me. You got to be a cause and an effect. And God want to be the effect of our life. The reason why you come to church, it ought to be because he affect you. Y'all ain't saying nothing. The only reason why I give the way I give, because it affect me. It's not the same as the world. The world does not do unless they are called. Y'all know what I'm saying? They don't arrest you because they got to be a call. You don't go get a job because they got to be a call. But God said in the kingdom, there got to be an effect. When was the last time that preaching infected you? When was the last time that the word infected you? When was the last time that the Holy Ghost, y'all ain't said nothing, infected you? By the word of God, God will work a miracle in your life. Look to your neighbor and say, I'm looking for a miracle. I believe the impossible. I see the invisible. Look to your neighbor and say, miracle, miracle, miracle. Y'all ain't having me preach miracle. Amen. An extraordinary event. Where do you get that from, brother preacher? Well, let's look at the text here. As I get ready to move on a little further, because verse 37 declares now that there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. It says, and it was in, he was in the hind part of the ship. He was asleep on a pillar, and they awake him and said unto him, Master, cares not
high. Seem as though they're beating upon you when it seems like pressure, adversity, and calamity is rising up and you're flooding in your soul. That's when you got to reach and get the word. When the enemy come in like a flood, he said that the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard. That's what I like about God. When the water comes to your ankle, he'll take you a little higher. And that one within your ankle, now it comes up to your knee. When it comes up to your knee, he'll take you a little higher. And now it comes up to your waist. When it comes up to your waist, he'll take you a little higher. And it'll come up to your neck. And when it overshadows you, he'll teach you how to swim. Anybody know what I'm talking about?
Miracle, but how many folks know that there was